Hello and welcome to The Barn Presents the Music of Elliot Davis. Tonight we'll be looking at Elliot's back catalogue ranging from Loserville out there. He also wrote the book to Soho Cinders and also the upcoming Broadway production of Becoming Nancy. Tonight, this is our third ever concert during the lockdown currently in the UK. We will be welcoming nine West End performers and James Bourne from the renowned band Busted that Elliot has worked with in the past. The Barn Theatre is a 200-seat theatre based in Cirencester in the Cotswolds. We have figured out that during this time of the lockdown, we have lost estimated £250,000. Through your support, through your donations, we have been doing these string of concerts and other online productions, including Bard from the Barn, Cool Conversations with Kenton Cool. If you'd like to donate or show your support in any way, you can via our website, which is www.barntheatre.org.uk/SOB, or on the number on the screen. Without further ado, shall we welcome our illustrious composer for the evening, Elliot Davis. Elliot, welcome.
Jamie.
Hey, thank you for joining us, really. Thank you. How have you been? How have you been over the last 3 to 4 months locked away?
It's been okay. I mean, it's tough. You know, we've got two young children, so homeschooling has become a joy. I actually do quite like it.
Really? Have you split up the responsibilities? Like, what subjects are you leading on?
Yeah, my partner works, so we've had to be, you know, and I work as well, obviously, and it's hard. It's sometimes hard to create, and I don't know if other creators are finding that you need some space to do that. So there's been a challenge about space, and it's not just about time, it's about physical space as well. But the homeschooling stuff, I sort of loved it. You know, we do, there's lessons online, and I do them every day, and my respect for teachers and their patience. I mean, I struggle with one child. Can you imagine having 30 in a room? And like my one's bored after 5 minutes. Can you imagine 30 bored children? I mean, these people are heroes. So that's what lockdown has taught me. You know, see a teacher, just bow down to them. Bow down, they are heroes.
Well, that's great. And like you said, this time, if it had, the one thing it has given us is time at home with our families. That's one big benefit. And to breathe and stop and actually just think. And I think so many people didn't realize how tired they were before this, like how exhausted they were mentally and physically. So yeah, it's now time to rest.
Yeah, it's so you know, a slower pace has come about, and maybe that's a positive, and maybe that will continue afterwards. You know, we don't know how the world will be. But certainly the time and space that it's given us has maybe caused to reflect.
No, I couldn't agree more. So obviously tonight we're going to be celebrating your music, and we've got nine fantastic performances by 10 phenomenal singers. So why don't you tell us a little bit about kind of what we're going to be hearing, really, the range of songs?
Well, there's songs from just looking at a list here, there's songs from Loserville, songs from Out There, and there's lots of songs that I'd written that aren't from shows, because I started I went to Warwick University, and I did politics, I was going to be a lawyer, but I was sort of far more interested in music, and I played piano from very, very early on, and I gone into musical theatre because of the Warwick Arts Centre. So I used to do all the shows for the university drama societies. And then I thought, do I really want to be a lawyer? Not really. And I saw a programme about Lionel Bart, you know, who wrote Oliver. Mm-hmm. And that was just as Cameron McIntosh was doing the Palladium production of Oliver. And I somehow found out who Lionel's accountant was. And I wrote to his accountant saying, can you pass this letter on to Lionel? And when I got back to university, there was a letter to me from Lionel Bart saying, call me on this number. And I did call him, and he said, come and see me if you're serious. And I went to see him, and he said, well, look, when you graduate, if you decide not to go to law school, give me a call. So I thought, you know, I'm going to give music a chance. And I'd always played piano. I mean, I played piano since I was very young and done all my grades at 12. So piano came sort of naturally to me. And then Lionel sort of just said, okay, well, let's work together. So he used to sing into a dictaphone. And at that time, I was writing stuff out for him. And it got me into musical theatre. And at the time, I had to earn money. Apart from that, I went round to all the stage doors just to rehearse to rehearsal piano. And my ambition started to want to play and MD the music, you know, and then I very quickly changed into actually I'd much rather people do my music so I don't have to turn up 8 times a week. It's laziness more than anything. So I was asked to write a show, which by my great friend Stephen Dexter. Mm-hmm. And on that show was Stephen Clark, who you'll hear songs from. And Stephen was a great lyricist. And because of that, I started to write musical theatre. And then I was on tour doing a show, and we were bored. And so I started to write songs for the lead member of that cast. And we went to the studio and some of the songs got heard. And then I got picked up by Warners and signed to Warners to write pop songs for other artists. So I had this musical career and then this pop thing going on, because I'd always loved pop. So I could sort of straddle both. And so some of the songs you'll hear from the musicals, some of them are just pop songs or songs that I've written that don't belong in a musical. But that's sort of the background.
Right. Well, so I'm sure I'm not the only one. The main thing I'm going to take away from that is if I want to become a composer, I'm going to email the accountant of the rich and powerful. And then that's how we get in, everyone. That is how we break
the cover. I remember at the time I was at university, this was probably, well, it was 20 years ago, floppy disks. You know, you couldn't Google someone. You couldn't, and I have no idea how I found out who his accountant was. And I literally, he hand wrote me a letter on blue paper, and I remember his phone number. And when I got back thinking, wow, he wrote me a letter. And then I called him up and that was it.
That's crazy.
It was amazing, yeah.
Like I said, it's pretty impressive to find his account. Or maybe that was the only person you could find. You were looking for everyone. Like, oh, well, I found his accountant. Like, why not?
Anyone would do it. And then since then, my association with Lionel had continued because I adapted the script or things in what they used to be. And when I was writing documentaries for Radio 2, which I've done a lot of, my first documentary for the BBC was about Lionel, which Matt Lucas and Barbara Windsor presented. And then recently I've written his life story for BBC Films.
Amazing. So
he's like been in my life all the way through, but it started with him and now it's sort of come back to him as well.
I hope you bought that accountant some flowers, right, for that introduction.
Of course. Of course.
Well,
I didn't.
You didn't at all, did you? You can't remember who it was. Just they'll forever live as the accountant. They have a name, the accountant. But no, amazing. And so obviously we're gonna start by listening to 3 songs.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell us a bit about these 3 songs?
So the first song is a song called "Long Run," which is a female sort of mid-tempo song that I wrote with James Bourne for the musical Loserville. We didn't quite love the song we had in that place. And when we first did Loserville, we were trying it out and then we went away. James and I went back to New York. We wrote Loserville in Los Angeles. I can't remember why, but we wrote it very quickly in Los Angeles. And it had done well when we tried it out, and then they wanted to put it into the West End. And we weren't happy about the song in that place, so we rewrote a song, and this is what we came up with. And I just, it's a powerful female stand center of the stage moment. And I love working with James, you know, he's a great, great, great writer. So we did that. And the second song is a song called The Coldest of Men, which actually is a pop song, a pop ballad that I wrote with Stephen Clark. When I got signed to Warners, I loved Stephen Clark's work, and Stephen wrote the lyrics for Martin Guerre. You'll hear more from him later. And also Love Story, and also Zorro. And he was a poet, and he passed away a couple of years ago. But I used to go down to Brighton where he lived, and we used to just sit and just write songs together. And I love the work, I love the lyrics to this. So we wanted to do it. And the way Jamie sings it really, it's beautiful and brought back all those beautiful memories of Stephen Clark. So listen to those words. And then the third song you're going to hear is also sung by James Bourne and co-written with James Bourne. And it's those happy days where you just go, just happy memories of writing songs. And James and I write, so it's so easy. He just sits with the guitar and we write this song. This is the song called "Learn to Dance," where an older man teaches his grandson something about romance.
Oh, nice.
And he teaches him, he's saying, if you really want to know about love, learn to dance. And it's how the grandfather met his wife. And he teaches the grandson about how to, this is what love's about. So it's a, I love it. I just love it. And I love the way James delivers it. It's, so we always wanted Kenny Rogers to do it, but Kenny passed away recently. So we'll have to find another country artist to do it. So, but learn to dance. Is how you get love.
Oh, amazing. Well, it sounds brilliant. Well, should we have a little listen to them then? So, Elliot, if you don't mind, if you'd like to introduce the next three songs.
So you've got Lucie Jones singing Long Run, you've got Jamie Muscato singing The Coldest of Men, and you've got the brilliant, brilliant James Bourne at home with his guitar singing Learn to Dance.
Amazing.
Last night I'll hold you this close. The last night we'll love till we sleep. Tomorrow we'll see two people again, only bound by the secret we keep. One more lifetime, too broken to save. Two more dreamers pretend to be brave. You know it's over when you know from the start there's no starting over again. And you feel nothing for the end that's begun has left you the coldest of men. We've known for too long we couldn't survive, but nothing we trust in has died. Perhaps given time and too many tears, we will see how the pain turns to pride. One more kiss now, too perfect to break. Two more lovers, but what does it take? You know that it's over when you know from the start there's no starting over again. And you feel nothing for the end that's begun has left you the coldest of men. It isn't that we don't know how to cope. Perhaps we lost faith, the courage to hold. Tonight's the last night we'll whisper this away. The last night we'll share the same dream. Tomorrow we'll see the lessons we've learned, but our smiles are not what they seem. One more heartbreak, two scars never heal. Two more people, but what do they starting over again. And you feel nothing for the end that's begun. It's left you the coldest of men. It's left you the coldest of men.
Hard to know what's right. I don't wanna go down without a fight. Even though the walls are closing in, I'm searching but there's no way out and I can't win. Every choice I see is coming with a possibility. You'll probably get hurt because of me. Regardless of the way I turn, you still get burned. But for a while, if I just pretend, it just might be worth it in the end. Worth it in the end. And the long run is the one thing on my mind when it comes to the someone You gotta make a sacrifice. Hearts will shatter, break and scatter. But what counts and what matters is what happens in the long run. The long run. It's a risk to take. It's not a simple choice for me to make. I know I have to dance among the lies. I'm gonna have to see the pain that's in your eyes for a while if I just pretend. It just might be worth it in the end. Worth it in the end. And the long run is the one thing on my mind. When it comes to the someone, you gotta make a sacrifice. Whoa. Hearts will shatter, break and scatter. But what counts and what matters is what happens in the long run. Is the one thing on my mind. When it comes to the someone, you gotta make a sacrifice. Hearts will shatter, break and scatter. But what counts and what matters is what happens in the long run.
Singing a song from the musical Out There that I wrote with Elliot Davis. It's called Learn to Dance.
Forever.
that was Lucie Jones, James Bourne, and Jamie Muscato. Next up, we've got Luke Bayer joining us. Welcome, Luke.
Hello, thank you.
Thank you for joining us. And I don't need to do any introductions between you and Elliot because you guys already know each other. You go way back, don't you?
We do, yeah.
So how did you two first meet?
We met at YMT, I think in 2011, so 9 years ago, doing Out There together, the show that I'm going to sing a song from. I did it in, where was the first one? Was it in Bracknell?
We did the first one in Bracknell, and then we did it again in London, didn't we?
At the Riverside Studios in Hammersmith.
Riverside Studios in Hammersmith, that's right.
Nice, beautiful venue.
Yeah, so we did that like nearly 10 years ago, which is crazy.
And have you had a chance to work with each other since?
Not directly, but obviously, Elliot, you wrote the book for Soho Cinders.
Oh, that's, yes, yeah, so I did that. Thank you for reminding me, because I was thinking, I'm sure we've done something, but yes. So I saw Luke do Soho Cinders at the Charing Cross just last year.
Yeah,
just last year, and he was amazing in it. So I didn't have much to do with that because it wasn't my production, but they were certainly, yeah, he was doing the script that I wrote with Anthony Drew, yeah.
I heard amazing things about that production. It sold, from what I heard, it pretty much sold out the Charing Cross. So it sounded like it was a really, really great show, and I was gutted I'd missed it. It's the joys of living in Cirencester. So Luke, why don't you tell us, like you said, you sung this song before, but why don't you tell us a bit about the song?
So it's sung by the lead protagonist in the show. I think that's right, the protagonist, Logan Carter. And he sings it at the start of the show when he's looking to leave. He's in trouble with the police. And my memory of it, Elliot, correct me if I'm wrong, I think this is what was said back in the day, a long time ago. Something about it, him being like, the best guy, his grandson.
Yeah, it's a story. It's a story about James and I wanted to write something about space. And I came up with an idea. What if Neil Armstrong was replaced by someone else at the last minute and wasn't able to be the first man on the moon and then ended up building a rocket in his barn and became the first, wanted to become the first non-NASA astronaut to go up to space? And what we did was that Neil Armstrong had a son who he'd left behind, and this son had a son. So there was three generations. So basically Luke played the grandson of Neil Armstrong, and Luke and his father don't get on, and he wants to run away. So you meet this 19-year-old kid who wants to run away, and where he runs away to, he has to deliver a letter given to him by his grandmother, the grandmother, puts the grandson and the grandfather together. That's sort of the story. And they don't know that. Wow. So it's really, but it's about three generations. It's about fathers. It's about replacing tragedy with hope. And at this point, this song is about just needing to get out, needing to escape the things that bother you. So we called it space because it's also about not only space, but needing space. It's also about space that the whole show is about. So nice. And I have to say, he nailed it 10 years ago, and he nails it again.
Thanks.
Perfect. Well, obviously that's not the only song we're going to be hearing. We're also going to be hearing another one by Aaron Sidwell. Elliot, why don't you tell us a bit about what Aaron's going to be singing?
So Aaron wanted to, I mean, obviously Aaron and I also go back a long way because Aaron starred in Loserville and then we did the concert together a few years ago, and he's just, you know, he's just great actor, great singer, great leading man in a company. I have someone who I have so much respect and time for. He heard this song. He wasn't in Out There when we did it, but Hope Is Fading Fast is about a town that has no hope. And Aaron wanted to sing a song because he just thought it resonated today.
Yeah.
And so that's what he did.
Yeah, so you let him. So let's not keep people waiting any longer. Luke, would you do us the pleasure of introducing us to the next two songs?
Absolutely. So I will be singing Space from Out There, and followed by that will be Aaron Sidwell singing Hope Is Fading Fast.
Grass, small town hope is fading fast. Train rolls through here once a week. It don't stop cause it's so bleak. Nothing grows here, nothing's good. The cattle wouldn't migrate if they could. Nothing to see here, there ain't no view. Don't know that they pass right through. This ain't a gold mine, it's just a ghost town. Well, maybe that's why it feels so goddamn run down. No faster than town to die. Average age is 85, what a blast. Hope is fading fast. It's fading fast. Life is slow here, we're all agreed. But I like watching tumbleweed. People can't live at their expense. What you just said don't make no sense. We can't go on like this, is clear. We'll all be gone this time next year. Better rack our brains cause we need a plan. Any ideas, put your hand down, Stan. This ain't a picnic. Yeah, this is do or die. And if we don't fix it, then we can kiss goodbye. We're hanging in there but only just. There's nothing left but dreams and dust that can last. Hope is fading. Fading, fading fast. Hope is fading, fading fast. This ain't no picnic. yeah, this is do or die. And if we don't fix it, then we can kiss goodbye. We're hanging in there, but only just. There's nothing left but dreams and dust, it can't last. Hope is fading fast. Hope is fading, fading fast. Hope is fading, fading fast. Hope is fading, fading fast.
So that was Aaron Sidwell and Luke Bayer. Now we welcome the delightful Jordan McMahon. Welcome, Jordan.
Hi.
Hey, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
How have you been finding lockdown so far?
It's all right. The first couple of weeks I was kind of like, what am I going to do? Because obviously I was at drama school and then it just all stopped. You know, like our end of year show got cancelled and we was in the middle of rehearsal for a play that just stopped, you know. I had to fly back to Ireland to be with my family. So it was just like, it really felt like the apocalypse had hit.
But how have you found the support from the industry to graduates at the moment? How have you found that?
Amazing. Especially right. Like the barn theatre, because I think that was like my first thing with the Bard from the Barn thing. Mm-hmm. That it like reignited my creativity and like let me interact with other people that weren't in my online classes for school, you know?
Yeah, no, completely. And obviously you've been doing a duet on this one with Sam Lupton and yes. The song How About Love. How have you found that? And how have you found it? Obviously, we've got Elliot here with us as well. So how have you found working on one of his songs?
I found it really interesting and it was really fun. The song is beautiful. Sam Young, who is the MD, he is just a genius and he was so lovely. And I think it's such an important song, especially for now and especially for everything that's happening. I think it's going to really resonate. But the Sam Lupton, it's just this phenomenal singer. He sent me his first draft vocal track that he did. And I was just listening to it like, oh my God, I'm going to have to sing with this person. He's a beautiful voice.
And Elliot, what about you? What about this song? Tell us a bit about the song.
Oh my God, I wrote this a long time ago. And I wrote it, I was signed to Warner's at the time. And you know, I don't know, there's something about simplicity which is the hardest thing. It's just hard. It's just hard to do simple. And I wanted to do the most simple, you know, when you lose your way and we all lose our way, what about this? And also, what about this? And also, what about this? And it's not all happiness, it's about tears as well. But tears can be releasing. And I wanted just to write something so simple. And the chords were purposely simple. Everything about it was simple, just to go straight to the heart. And I wrote it when a long time ago. And I sent it to Warner's and they were like, oh, we just love this song and da 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 da. And then a myriad of different artists were going to sing it, none of whom ever did. And eventually I was writing a new musical with my friend Sam Kenyon at the time called Best Friends and Butterflies, and we put it in that show. And you know, it just affected people. It just affected people, and everyone who heard it just loved it. And it stays, you know, as one of my favorite things that I've ever done. And
and now you're trusting it over to Jordan and Sam.
And you know, I heard what they did, and they you know, they rinsed it for all the meaning, and I just loved what they did with it. So. Beautiful.
Great.
Thank you. Obviously, that means so much.
So obviously this isn't the only song we're going to be hearing next. We're also going to be hearing Josh Slovick singing Gloria. Why don't you tell us a bit about that song, Elliot, and how that came about?
So Gloria, I was working with a record company and we had this, they had this act that was like the new Monkees. I don't know if you know the Monkees, they were from like, yeah. They wanted to do a Monkees and they wanted to do a TV. And they put me together with someone called Graham Gouldman. And Graham Gouldman is the phenomenal writer of all the 10cc songs. You know, he's in 10cc, So I'm Not in Love, Dreadlock Holiday. And Graham and I, we just got on. We just loved each other. And we ended up sort of trekking for Teenage Cancer Trust around the world together because we just clicked. And Gloria, I mean, Graham is one of the world's best songwriters. He's a phenomenal songwriter. And Gloria is a song we wrote together with my beautiful friend, Adam Bard. And Adam came from a musical theatre background, now lives in New York. And Graham and I had this tune and we had an idea, and we teamed up with Adam Bard to write the lyrics for Gloria. And again, last year, or was it the year before, Bill Kenwright called me and said, oh, I'm doing something with Joe McKeldry. And he said, you got anything? And I went, yeah, have a listen to this. And Bill went, oh my God, I love it. I'm going to play it to Joe. And Joe released it last year. And then Bill sent me a text saying, you've just got me a number 5 on the download charts. I've always wanted, and look who's, you know, you did that. And I was getting off a plane. He said, you've made my dreams come true with that song. Typical Bill. He's so lovely. But yeah, Joe did a great job on it. But Joss, I have known since, I mean, Joss has a singular voice. It's just incredible. And what I saw in Joss when he was so young, everyone else has seen since. He's just blossomed into this phenomenal artist, but not only an artist in terms of singing, as a performer as well. And, you know, his vocals in 1917, the Sam Mendes film just happened, have gone around the world. And the clarity and pureness of his voice is just, I think, world class. So it's always a joy to hear Joss sing anything, but it's a pleasure to hear him sing this.
Well, it was a pleasure when he signed up. And Jordan, have you seen the film 1917?
Yes, I have. And it was just incredible. I loved I got my nails done at the time, and by the end of the film, my nails were like all like bitten off, like all the paint, because I was just sat like this the whole time, just completely captivated. It was amazing.
It is. And then literally the moment where Joss sings, where it's like the kind of, if you haven't seen 1917, if you watch it, it's kind of, they go through this huge kind of journey, and then at the end they kind of slump, and there's just this beautiful male vocal where they were all the soldiers are sitting around listening to this one man sing, and it's Joss, and it's phenomenal. It's just this kind of perfect break in this perfect film. But well, I digress. But Jordan, should we? Would you do us the honours of introducing yourself and the next two songs?
This is me, Jordan McMahon, and the immensely talented Sam Lupton singing "How About Love," and the next we're going to have Joss Slovick singing "Gloria."
When the night starts to fall upon you and the dark is slowly creeping in, lost your hope and don't know where you're going, can't remember where you've been, can't go forward if you've no direction, can't go up if you can't see the sun, lost the answer to the simple question, what's the point for anyone? How about love? How about blue skies? How about laughter? How about a sunrise? How about tears? How about hope? How about love? Yeah, how about love?
With the whole world on your shoulders, and there's simply nothing left to say. You don't believe that there'll be hope tomorrow. Tough just getting through today. Yesterday seemed to be so easy. Now you turn to block out all the noise. You're losing track of all the good around you. Can't remember any simple joys. How about
love?
How about love?
How about love?
How about love?
you broken. For all the fight, there's nothing there to show. You've reached the end, you're up against the wall. No way out, no place for you to go.
No place for you to go.
No place for you to go. How about love?
How about love?
How about the sky?
How about the sky?
How about laughter?
How about his eyes?
How about tears? How about hope?
Inside her heart, she's just a girl who doesn't have a single care in the world. Just now and then she knows what might have been if only life were lived in dreams. In bed alone, closing her eyes, she imagines that he's there by her side, and all the years of blessings love once knew, remembering helps to pull her through. Gloria. Up with the sun, so much to do. Her children sleep another hour or two. The table's ready when they come downstairs. They'll never miss what isn't theirs. Gloria. Wouldn't hide their sins for Gloria. Hosanna, lovely as her name. Oh, understand her. She thinks she's too. She gives her all. A mother stumbles, but she won't ever fall. And when you need to know that one still cares, look to your heart, she's always there. Gloria.
So that was John McMahon and Sam Lupton and Josh Slovick. Now we have the delightful pleasure of welcoming Aaron Lee Lambert. Welcome, Aaron. Hello.
Hello. Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm well, thanks. Very well.
And obviously, thank you for joining us tonight and singing a song for us. How have you found this whole routine and regime, I guess, of having to do this from home and singing from home?
It's kind of much of the same. You know, we kind of learn songs on our own in a room oftentimes. So it's kind of that, only you just don't get as much immediate feedback, which sometimes you second guess and then re-record. Like I did record it about 5 or 6 times, but because I'm a bit of a perfectionist. But
yeah. Well, what you sent over is phenomenal. So thank everyone's you. In for a huge treat. No.
Oh, thank you.
Absolutely amazing. And I said, you haven't worked with Elliot before. So how have you found this link up?
It's been great. I've been a fan of Elliot's for a while. When I was in drama school, some of the students in my course, they did a new musical module and they did Best Friends and Butterflies. So I was familiar a bit with his work at that point. I saw Loserville, and so kind of just been keeping track. And when I was asked to do this, I was like, absolutely. So yeah, it's been great. It's been great to, especially the song that I was assigned. It's kind of a standalone song, and it's a storytelling song. So it was really exciting to kind of tackle that and tell a story.
No, great. And well, Elliot, why don't you tell us a bit more about the song? It's called The Village Song, and that's as much as I'll tell them.
So the Village Song was, I was signed to Warner's, and I'd heard this guy sing, a guy called Andy Stocks, and he was a guitar player from Hull, now lives in California, and I just loved his voice, and I just found him. I can't even remember how, and we hooked up, and I wrote some songs for him, and he wanted to write songs, and we ended up getting some money together for an album. So we needed to write a whole album's worth of songs, and we recorded it at Britannia Rose Studios, I remember. And it's on Spotify. It's called Picking Up the Penny, this album with Andy Stocks. And we wanted a great song to close it. And I love New York. I spend loads of time there. I've been writing there a lot. And we wanted to write, you know, and the people that I loved, the artists that I loved, were the, like Billy Joel and the Eltons. And piano was my first instrument. So I sat down at the piano and I just channeled my inner Elton. Can you imagine that? What would that look like?
It apparently it looks like the Village Song.
You should have seen what I was wearing. I channeled that, and piano's my first instrument, and what it had, and I loved the way it started in, it sort of started minor, then the verse started major, and then it changes key, and it's that style of songwriting that I just loved. And so we wrote this, and then Andy teamed up with a beautiful lyricist called Matthew Davidson, and we wanted it to about that longing for New York. Mm-hmm. And sometimes your way to New York is not a straight line. And so we wrote about an imagining of someone who'd been through lots of states and just go, you know, I'm going to sit with my mates in a bar and I'm going to work out what to do. And he says halfway through the song, I've worked it out. Going to New York, and there's lots of times in my life when I thought let's just settle down there, and I haven't yet, but it's a song about settling there. And you know, we watch what's going on in America. It's still a beautiful city. It's full of beautiful people, and Broadway is going through such a hard time. The West End is too, and you know, yeah. I long for those happier times, and the way Aaron, you delivered the song just pulled at my heartstrings for those.
Thank you.
I think everyone's in for a huge treat with it, and I think I'll speak for a lot of people, but when things go back to normal and things can resume, I'll be jumping straight over to New York again, because it's such a phenomenal city, as you say, and the work out there is incredible. So hopefully next time we all chat, we'll be able to take a trip there together, or Jane, at least we'll be able to leave our homes. That would be a good starting point, I guess. Mm-hmm. So obviously that's Aaron's song isn't the only song we're going to be hearing next, and obviously these are the last two songs of the concert. So Aaron's song will be our finale, but our song just before that will be Aimie Atkinson. So Elliot, why don't you tell us a bit about what Aimie will be singing?
Aimie sings Lifetime of Love, and I wrote Lifetime of Love. It came as a tune first, and I gave it to my brilliant, brilliant friend, Stephen Clark. And Stephen Clark passed away a couple of years ago, was a lyricist par excellence. I mean, he was just extraordinary as a dramaturg, as a lyricist, and he's also inspirational in the way that he took me and others under his wing when we were starting out. So I wrote my first, very first musical with Stephen. And Stephen wrote the lyrics for Martin Guerre. He also wrote Love Story, amongst Zorro, so many great shows. And he wrote a lyric for this, which I just loved. And I miss him dearly. And when I heard Aimie sing it again, it brought it all back. And he's listened to the words, because he's an extraordinary writer, and his work lives on. And I'm glad I've had a tiny part in writing with him. An extraordinary talent, Stephen Clark.
Wow, that's amazing. That's a beautiful, beautiful story. And I think it's like you said, it's the perfect kind of duo of songs to end this concert with, really. And just before we do listen to the songs, and sorry for making everyone wait even longer, but I have to say a thank you to Elliot. Obviously, thank you for letting us celebrate your work, and obviously listening to it, and hopefully introducing a lot of people to it as well. And obviously, thank you, Aaron, for joining us. And and for everyone else.
Thank you, Aaron. Huge thank you.
Thank you for having me.
No. Is a huge honor because of the fact that yourself and all the other performers involved in this, it's such a hard time for everyone right now. We know that obviously this is to celebrate obviously Elliot's music, obviously to keep musical theatre alive at the moment, and also to try and help raise some money for the Bourne Theatre. But we completely appreciate that the Bourne is not the only theatre or individual kind of entity out there that needs help right now. So for you to give your time for us, it does mean the world. So really, thank you for that.
No worries.
And thank you for everyone who's watching, donating and listening. We really, really appreciate your time. And we really, really appreciate your support. And like we said before, fingers crossed, sooner rather than later, we can go back to normal and be doing one of these concerts live to you all. So without further ado, Aaron, would you like to introduce the final two songs?
Yeah, absolutely. Next up, we have Aimie Atkinson singing Lifetime of Love. And after that, you'll get me singing The Village Song.
whispered my name. Tell me nothing's the same. All the fears I've been facing, all the dreams I've been chasing. Now at last it's so clear. Now tomorrow is here. I can feel that we're winning, and we're only beginning. Since you gave me a lifetime of love.
The Golden Gate, a brand new state, a part of you. We walked on the golden sands, our hands so tight not to separate. Virginia State, shall we wait? No one can lose. Have a drink with Ted and Drew, decided what the hell I'm gonna do. She had a dream of America. What state are we gonna go? Let's settle down in New York City. Yellow cabs, they look so pretty. The village that never grew old. I'm at the bar, it seems so busy. Forget about my home. The boulevard strikes a note and I've been sold. Wave goodbye to Ted and Drew. We got in Mandalay. The 54, a downtown show. Black or red. Ooh. Empty pockets and a loosened tie. Life's roller coaster ride. The Vegas Strip, no more to tip. I'll leave this town. I've had a drink with Ted and Drew. Decided what I'm gonna do. I dream of America, a place that I will call my home. I settle down in New York City. Yellow cabs, they look so pretty. The village that never grew old. I'm at the bar, it seems so. Forget about my former home. The boulevard strikes a note and I've been sold. Yeah, 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 yeah. Settle down in New York City. Yellow cabs, they look so pretty. The village that never grew old.
Mm-hmm. March 2018, we opened our doors to the public with a vision not just to create challenging professional theatre, but to use this as a platform to inspire and bring communities together. Theatre and culture build identity. With theatre and culture in our local life, the community landscape is more vibrant. Local life is enriched. We believe that the benefits of theatre should be available for everyone. Our Theatre for All programme has removed financial barriers, giving disadvantaged people access to the theatre free of charge.
So we were told that we'd come here and have the Christmas meal and then go and watch A Christmas Carol.
Our aim is to make live professional theatre available to everyone and use that experience for positive change. Theatre can be transformational in young lives. Our academy is now in its fourth year, and we continue to build on our vision of bringing the best performing arts tuition to the heart of the Cotswolds. We work hard to make our academy as inclusive and as accessible as possible. Discounts apply for parents with more than one child. Our bursaries help support talented children from less affluent backgrounds. The Academy creates a fun and challenging environment where children can build friendships and develop key skills, not just for theatre, but for life. We are also able to provide real opportunities for students who wish to pursue careers in the arts.
My name is Harry Apps. I am currently playing Marius in Les Miserables in the West End.
Bourne outreach and learning programmes engage with thousands of people. Our free workshops support the drama curriculum in local schools. Singing and musical theatre workshops in community groups and care homes have helped address issues of isolation. Our Song for Cirencester project in aid of mental health charities brought our community together in an unprecedented way. We've collaborated with many charities in the region, including the Churn Project, to support individuals dealing with the barriers to finding work.
Since working with UN, my life's changed. It's given me some purpose, given me an interest, some confidence I was lacking prior to all this.
The Bourne Theatre played a pivotal role in the town's 2018 World War I centenary celebrations. Who could forget our record-breaking human poppy? Our live streaming work on the annual Advent Festival helped thousands engage and take part in Cirencester's Christmas festivities. In these times of uncertainty, we strive to keep the community together. The theatre may be temporarily closed, but our commitment to you goes on. Even now, our amazing costume department are helping the NHS by making scrubs for frontline workers. We've used our technology to build a free live streaming service that provides much needed community news and entertainment for all the family. Broadcasting every day to keep us all connected. We are not just a theatre. We are the Bourne.